Most of the twins paradox explanations go through a similar scenario to this, where one twin is on the Earth and the other is in a spaceship. The problem with this is that it leads you to easily dismiss the first postulate of Einstein's special relativity. It is called the principle of relativity, and it requires that both of these scenarios that you're seeing are equally valid. It is easier for people to understand that the twin on the Earth is actually at rest and the spaceship is doing all of the moving. But the scenario where the planet and the star are moving and the spaceship is at rest should not be discarded. Otherwise, why have the principle of relativity at all if you're always going to discard one of the scenarios? I prefer the scenario where you just have empty space and two spaceships. But you might be thinking that the twin paradox is not a paradox at all, or it's already been solved. This is just a small list of peer-reviewed journal papers by physicists trying to explain the twins paradox. Obviously, you can see that there are different methods being used to try to explain it, and the debate is still ongoing. So back to the scenario. We have empty space, and this spaceship is moving at a fast rate to the left. You're going to see that it is passing another spaceship that is sitting at rest. Sorry, just kidding. This is the spaceship that is at rest, and then you're going to see another one fly by. There it goes. It's the same animation either way. So that's the idea of the principle of relativity. You can't tell which one is at rest or which one is moving. So both reference frames have a valid point of view in this case. Let's take a look at Einstein's 1905 paper and what he says about the principle of relativity. Einstein is proposing to get rid of this idea of a universal at rest. And now any coordinate system can claim that they are at rest as long as they meet the criteria of constant motion or no motion. Coordinate systems that are accelerating or decelerating do not apply to the principle of relativity. At the start of section 2, Einstein again defines the principle of relativity. I put up a second translation here because the wording is kind of clumsy. So in one of the scenarios, this spaceship was at rest. We will assign it a time equals 2. That way we can calculate what the moving spaceship's clock looked like. So to the stationary spaceship, it looked like the moving spaceship's clock was slower. Okay, there's no problem at this point, but using the principle of relativity, we can say that this spaceship was at rest and this one was moving. So we have a rest time of 2, and now this one has a clock that is moving slower. This is the basic clock paradox, and this is the beauty of the principle of relativity. It's very symmetric. But it creates an illogical contradiction. Which clock is actually moving slower? Now, some explanations just say, who cares, it's a disagreement about clocks. Now, this is where the twins come in. What you do is you replace the clocks, you make it a little bit more serious by putting in a biological clock. So now you can say, wait a second, if it's two twins, how do they age if both clocks are moving slower? It makes no logical sense to say that both twins are aging slower at the same time. So this is how simple the twins paradox really is. You don't need to go into some complex scenario. All you're doing is just making a slow clock seem a little bit more real. Now, there's no solution to this, but Einsteiners will explain their way out of pretty much anything. So the next logical step would be to say, hey, we have a valid math answer from the relativity equations right here and right here. So two valid math answers, they both can't be right. So which math answer is the correct one? Again, the first postulate of Einstein's relativity is the principle of relativity, and it is giving us all of this information. So let's look at this in a different way. Let's go down one more layer and just ask, well, who is really doing the moving? Einstein's relativity has math that depends on velocity. For example, in order to calculate these clocks, we need to know who is actually moving. They depend on a speed. And right now, the principle of relativity is telling us that they're both at rest and they're both moving. That is an obvious logical contradiction. So let's just look at this as a velocity paradox. Here are the relativity equations that are applied to the coordinate system that is moving. This is the time coordinate or clock, and this is x, y, and z of the moving system. This is where the slower moving clock comes from, and it requires a velocity. So the first postulate of the principle of relativity says that you can be at rest or you can be the moving frame. But we have specific math for the moving frame. That is the paradox, and the special relativity theory itself does not have a resolution for it. It doesn't tell you which one is moving. So you get the two slowing clock paradox, or the aging twins issue. And now you know that it gives you two different answers, but doesn't tell you which one is correct. So in special relativity, you can't have each frame claiming that they're moving and not moving. It just doesn't work. It is absolutely a logical contradiction or paradox. It has not been resolved. So here we have an example of Einstein's mind virus. The theory declares a symmetrical relationship, but this theory requires asymmetry in order to resolve the clock paradox, or to figure out who is actually moving faster. Symmetry and asymmetry are exact opposites, so both of these cannot be correct. So why does Einstein's theory have the principle of relativity if you're always trying to get rid of it to resolve these paradoxes? Most of the twins' explanations have this workaround built in. Many times the explanations try to invalidate a frame. And what that means is one of the frames will claim to be influenced by gravity or acceleration, deceleration, which means it does not apply to special relativity. That invalidated frame is then said to be the one that is moving. Another common workaround is to explicitly say or agree which frame is at rest. This way is a little sneakier at how to go about invalidating Einstein's principle of relativity. But what it's really doing is kind of bringing back the idea of absolute space. Or the relativity theory that was prior to Einstein, they used the ether as the at-rest reference frame in the universe. So again, if you're going to use these types of workarounds to invalidate a frame or declare who is moving and who is at rest, then why do we even have the first postulate in Einstein's theory of relativity? The answer to that is because it is used in section 2 of his paper when he tries to define something called relative simultaneity. Now, this is where the actual bug in Einstein's theory lives. In a future video, I will be doing a walkthrough that shows you exactly how to invalidate the entire theory of relativity via relative simultaneity. And thanks for watching.